Good morning and welcome to worship at Summit Community Church. It's January 16th, 2022, and we're all in a good mood here, ready to praise the Lord. And let's stand and sing together, Christ the Solid Rock.
My hope is built on open my eyes so I can see the wonderful things that you do. Open my heart up more and more and make me wholly devoted to you. It is the fire of my heart to follow you. It is the fire of my heart to be close to you. It is the fire of my heart to follow all the days of my life.
Sing the chorus one more.
It is the fire of my heart to follow you. It is the fire of my heart to be close to you. It is the fire of my heart to follow all of the days of my life. All of the days of my life. All of the days of my life.
Father, we do wish to follow you today. We are so grateful that you wish for us to find you. You wish for us to follow and find you, that you may gather us together as your children, adopted heirs, as your sons and daughters, Lord. You've called us to join your family. That is your goal for this entire journey that we are on in this life, is for us to find you and to be gathered into your family. We thank you, Lord, that you would show us this so clearly in such a beautiful story today as we study in John chapter 8, how you wish to gather us. But Father, we fight against you and we wish to destroy and cancel one another and block each other out of the family. I pray that you would remove all barriers between us, Lord, that we would see that there is absolutely not one person in this earth that you do not wish to be your child. In Jesus' name, amen. We ask that, be seated, please. We've got a couple of quick announcements. We are back on our normal routine. Is that correct for Bible study, Frank? Thursday's Bible study is going again?
Yeah, we were supposed to have it. Pastor Dan was sick again.
Oh, okay. So, give Frank a call before you go. He'll let you know. Or Dan, one or the other. We are hoping that Dan feels better. I didn't know that he was sick, so.
Yeah, she'd say it must have been a sugar or something. She said he had a blueberry muffin, and then he got sick.
Okay. Well, let's hope that Dan gets feeling better. We also have Bible study on Wednesday at 2, or 1 o'clock, Thursday at 2, Wednesday at 1 o'clock here at the church. And let's see, are there any other announcements? I'm trying to think of any other announcements. Nope. Okay. You should have got your giving statements. I saw Kathy handing those out. Thank you, Kathy, for getting those ready. We appreciate you all the hard work you do for us. Thank you. Thank you. We are in the process of getting a group together to help us on the church. It's been slow going with COVID and everything. Everybody's kind of just not in that workday mode right now in January, I'm finding out. So everybody's like, well, workday in January. So it may just be LB and I and CC out there putting stuff up soon. But we'll work on that. We've got a lot of prayer requests today. Let's just jump right into our prayer time. I talked to the Moore family this week. Pat has gone back to Texas. I put Texas up there. I was incorrect. It's actually Phoenix. It's where she's going down for treatment, down to Arizona. And Pat is not doing well. She's got cancer in a lot of places. So we need to be praying for her and her family. They're all pretty shell-shocked by the news. Pat is kind of the matriarch of that family, so she's the glue. So they're all needing your prayers for the whole family. Is it Chantrell?
Chanel.
I put the wrong one. Chantrell is the mushroom. That's what it was. Chanel. Chanel and Bryson lost their home due to a fire.
Chanel and Grayson.
Grayson?
Yeah, Grayson and
okay, Chanel and Grayson, just ignore that second line. Chanel and Grayson McIntyre are in North Carolina.
North Carolina.
And they lost their home to a fire. So we're praying for them to, God to supply their needs. We also are grateful for some news we got this morning about Claudia's sister. We prayed for her last week. She was diagnosed with cancer. She had a positive diagnosis that they don't think it's as severe as they feared originally. So they're not even going to do chemo at this point. They're just going to remove the sores and be done with it. So Gloria is, that's good news. It's wonderful. Sally, on the other hand, Claudia's coworker, has had a pretty grim diagnosis, but she is taking chemotherapy and the tumors are shrinking. So, but she's got a lot of tough days ahead. Also pray for Laureen and Julia Bolden. Both are struggling with memory issues. That's Frank Jr.'s wife and mother. And we also want to pray for Rebecca Hayward. We're praising God that her cysts have shrunk with treatment. Also for Lonnie Walker, that's Frank's friend with emphysema, old army buddy. And we also want to continue to pray for John Clowers, that's a friend of Kathy's that... friend of Dee Dee.
My ex-husband, and his, he just got pathology results, and they were benign.
Oh my, wonderful. That's a wonderful praise.
Yes.
Oh good. You had another friend that passed away, Bill. Or no, that has cancer, Bill Schmidt. Yeah, how's he doing? Okay. So that's good news.
That's a praise.
That's a wonderful praise that John is going to be okay. He's got benign tumor, so that's good. Penny, she has been scheduled for surgery this Thursday, the 20th, and Dee Dee's going to be able to go with her and stay with her, and we hope.
It's unclear if both Rick and I can stay that night with her. We have okay, I think, for us to both be at the hospital and Penny says, but I don't know if us, if I'm in the hospital, they're not kicking me out. I'm staying in the hospital. I mean, I don't think that they can just say, yes, you're invited, and then say, no, go away. So, the plan is for me to stay there with her. She wants to be there, so I will be there.
Okay, good. Yeah, I think these hospitals, we need to start pushing back a little bit and say, let's move on.
Well, in the news this morning, that hospital is no longer requiring full vaccination.
Okay.
So I'm fully vaccinated, so it shouldn't be a problem. Also, it's pretty tough surgery. Please pray for her.
Okay.
It's going to be a long one.
Long surgery, so...
And recovery is...
Yeah, she's going to be in the hospital for several days afterwards. So let's pray for Penny. She goes in Thursday, and Dee Dee will be with her.
And pray for Rick as well.
Pray for Rick as well. Rick and Penny Nicholas are their names. Want to remember Frank and Tracy both dealing with their cancer, getting treatment, good days and bad days. And pray for Mark. He was a little under the weather today. And also for Dean, our friend on hospice care, and for all those that are fighting cancer, for those that we've mentioned, plus Jim Kraft, he's still in our heart. He has only been given a few months to live, so let's just continue to pray for Gloria and as she ministers to Jim as well. And then Bill Schmidt, Penny, we just mentioned, Beth Barnes, Marlene and Terry Rennie, Lana Runkel, David Winters, Cheryl Ledoux, Francis Mulliner, Sally Harada, and Gloria Motley. But some of those praises we were really glad about. Is there any other prayer requests? Yes, ma'am.
Cheryl Ledoux was expected to fully recover, and we just found out that she's going to have to go back for chemo. And my brother that was here, he's had a lot of grief lately.
Mm-hmm.
His sister-in-law passed away, and we were at the funeral when that fire came through, and his son, Michael, lived a mile away from there, so there's that, and then he gets to go see all that devastation every day when he drives, and all the people that lost everything. And that, he just texted me that he lost one of his best friends, and the joy is he's a Christian, whereas last night we went to see a friend who just lost her husband, and I don't think he was a Christian. So it's, you know, when you know when people are going to heaven, you miss them. But when you know they're not, it's hard.
Yeah.
It's just hard.
So what is your brother's name again?
Jim.
So we'll pray for Jim and all the grief that he's dealing with and getting through. Any other prayer requests? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. We praise you, Lord, for the way that you sustain us through all circumstances. Even in the midst of the darkest day, you are with us. Even when we sense you or don't sense you, you are there. And we thank you, Lord, that you have us in the palm of your hand at all times. We pray for all those that are suffering with cancer that we've mentioned here on this list. Lord, there's so many. We pray for their long-suffering spirit, that you would strengthen them and encourage them and be with them, Lord. Pray for all those that are ministering to them, that they might have the ability to encourage even in the very darkest of days. Father, we pray that you might make us the steadfast supporters of those that are suffering. Father, we pray also today for Chanel and Grayson as they lost their home in this fire in North Carolina. Pray as they continue to recover that you'd be with them and sustain them and supply all their needs. We also, Father, want to ask for your prayers upon Lorraine and Julia Bolden, who are both struggling with memory issues, as well as my sister. Pray for all those that are dealing with dementia, and Dean, our friend Dean Hager as well, Lord. We just ask that you'd bless them and clear up their confusion in their spirit, Lord. Even though their brain may not be working properly, we know their spirit is intact, and we thank you, Father, that you communicate with them probably beyond the words that we understand. Father, we also want to pray for Lonnie Walker as he deals with his emphysema. Pray that you might be with him. And we praise you, Lord, for the good news that we've had for those today, for Gloria Motley and for John Clowers, who both received good diagnosis with their cancer. We pray that you would continue to work, and we celebrate that wonderful news. Father, we pray also for Tracy and Frank today, who are with us, and just ask that your blessing be with them as they deal with their cancer, as you give them the energy to get through each day. Pray that you might strengthen them and bring them back to health. Father, we glorify you for all of these things. We thank you. We know that the grief that comes upon us can be so strong when we lose those we love. But we also know, Lord, that for those that know you, we can glorify you. And we mourn for those, Father, who are without you. Father, we pray that you would sustain us as we minister to others. Their time is short and we have so much work to do. But help us to learn what it means to love one another, what it truly means, that we would not seek to defeat an enemy, but we would seek to reconcile a lost sheep. We pray for all those that are here today, Lord, and pray that you might bless the tithes and offerings that we'll now receive at this time of offering. May you bless the gift as well as the giver, in Jesus' name, amen. Counselor, Almighty.
forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit.
By your amazing love. I thank you for the model that you give us in Jesus to show us what true love is. In Jesus' name, amen. So there's something going on in our culture right now, and I decided to link today's story to it because it happens so frequently now that it's so annoying. but it's not new. Of course, I'm talking about cancel culture. It is one of the most annoying things that you will ever have to endure in modern American life today. Cancel culture is when we see it when someone becomes the object of scorn and a group of people decide that they're going to go after them to give them kind of the coup de grace, the death blow, to make sure that they can never come back in public life without hanging their head in shame. Sometimes it just takes a single word, as Dan Quayle learned when he tried to write potato. Or no, it was written on his chalkboard. It was the word potato was written up there. And the media decided that they could make hay out of that. So they said he misspelled it, but he didn't misspell it. He was just pointing it out on the chalkboard, and somebody else thought it was misspelled. And he said, it is? Does it have an E on the end or something? And that's all it took. And he was ridiculed to this day. If you look it up on Wikipedia, there's a paragraph about a potato and how it's spelled. Crazy. I mean, it's not like he accidentally pushed the nuclear button or anything, you know? He was just the vice president. You say you'd like him, you didn't like him, but over a word that he didn't even misspell. But someone can seize on that. And that's an important part of cancel culture. You see, if I stand up and I mock you or make fun of you, it goes unnoticed by most people. Just the people that were there know about it. But when it gets picked up by others and amplified, and other people jump on, and other people, it creates this tsunami wave that could just run over someone. People make huge mistakes, and nobody notices, but then somebody makes a small mistake, and they can be run out of civilized society forever. I mean, sometimes people are rightly convicted of crimes and put in prison. They have to serve some time to pay their debts to society to make sure that we... And the whole reason for that isn't just to punish someone. It's to shape cultural behavior. That's really why we put people in jail, to be truthful about it. It's not just to punish. It is to tell other people there are consequences for that kind of behavior. And if you do that, you're going to go away for a while. You don't belong in polite society. That happened one night when I was in a group of guys, and this guy was being a little crazy and wild, which is very unusual. I'm not around violent people very often, and he was threatening a friend of mine. And I said, well, that seems a little inappropriate. To which he began to tell me I was next. And I stood there thinking, I'm not really a big fan of what you just did. And I happened to know the owner of the establishment where this happened. And I walked over to him and said, this man's making threats. And I had him canceled. The owner of the establishment came over and said, you are never allowed in here again for the rest of your life. He took his picture and said, get out. You will never threaten anybody in my place of business ever. You'll never do it twice. And so I canceled someone. Now, I have hardly ever done that in my life, but I canceled him. It happened again in another situation where someone was being very hostile to another person, and I made sure that that person was no longer welcome. That's very rare where that needs to be done. It's very rare. It may need to be done. Jesus did it. The cleansing of the temple. He was canceling the culture that had grown up in the temple, right? He walked into the temple with a whip made of cords that had, it was an offensive weapon, folks. It was not just, he wasn't waving a belt around. He had a whip and he was slinging it, trying to get people to move out away from their tables. They had these little booths set up where they were selling things there in the temple. And he said, this is my father's house. It's a place of worship, and you've turned it into a den of thieves. So Jesus did that. But he didn't do it as a matter of practice or anything. That was not something he did with any kind of frequency. He was showing that was an egregious violation of the spirit of the temple. And when they would move, he used force. Now, he didn't tell them they had to leave the temple grounds necessarily. He just said, you're not going to sell that junk in the temple while I'm here. He was purifying the culture that had become polluted with commerce. So, I'm not going to say that it doesn't happen in Scripture, because it does. But it is not the spirit of Scripture at all. And today we have the story in John chapter 8 that is one of the most iconic stories of Jesus' ministry. And that's when the woman was brought to him who was caught in the act of adultery. Jesus really had a challenging relationship with the Pharisees. But I think I've been pretty clear. I don't believe we should look at the Pharisees as his enemies, as I have for most of my life. The Pharisees were not his enemy. He did not treat them as enemies. Now, I say that, but by the end of this chapter, you may question me because he calls them sons of Satan. Okay? There's not much more of a harsh rebuke that you could ever utter to a Pharisee than calling him a son of Satan. However, Jesus did not regard them as his enemies. I think we see here again today in this story. We're going to do this in two parts. This week, today, we're going to focus on the role of the Pharisees in this story, in this incident. We're going to look at how Jesus dealt with that. Then next week, we're going to look at something very different. How he dealt with the woman. But I think when we get to the end of that sermon next week, you're going to see that he really was doing the same thing for both people, both groups of people, the woman caught and the Pharisees who wanted to kill her or cancel her. What is it about cancel culture that has caught on so rapidly? I believe it could really be explained by the internet. I believe that the internet allows a group of online bullies who remain nameless and faceless to whip up an uproar among a group of people who then can translate that into media amplification. I believe that's what's happening. And the media is all too eager to jump on board when it's someone they don't like. When it's one of the people that they support or that they like or someone that they might have a relationship, you won't hear a word about it. If a politician is caught in an embarrassing situation, if he's good friends with the editor at the newspaper, that particular paper will have a much different take on it than the other ones, right? That's because, hey, I know that guy. He's not like that. Right. When we know people, they're not like that. But if we don't, we can make someone sound evil that is not. We can make someone sound dangerous when they're not. And that's what I think is happening in our culture now with the cancel culture, so that one mistake on someone's part can be amplified online, and then the purge begins. It's really brutal. It happens in junior high school, mostly with girls. Girls experience cancel culture at an early age because their group of friends can sometimes turn on them. We have an alarming rate of suicide among teenage girls. It's very dangerous. I think it's only gotten, I don't think, I know it has gotten twice as bad with the advent of the internet. In the last 20 years, we have seen dramatic increases increases in the amount of suicide among teenagers, the rate of suicide. More teenage girls than boys, but as they get older, boys are more likely to take their own life. So we have to look at this and say, this is a matter of life and death. It is something that we really need to pay attention to. When someone is held up as the object of scorn and ridicule, they are in a uniquely vulnerable position, especially if they already struggle emotionally. They may not survive, because all it can take is one incident to make them feel that they are completely unworthy of life and they take their own life to end their own suffering. Cancel culture does that. It's even gotten so bad that people have died, not just from suicide. Another way that cancel culture has happened is people will do what they think is kind of a prank, or they call it kind of a prank, but it's very dangerous. They will call in a break-in or a hostage situation to somebody's house that they don't like. And if that person makes the wrong move, they may be shot and killed, and many have. Almost a dozen people by the last count have been killed in these, they call them swattings, what are they called? Yeah, it's when they SWAT people by, they call it, hopefully a SWAT team will show up, and if they come to the door all groggy and they have a gun or something, they can get killed. I mean, that's what has happened on several occasions. So that is how bad it can get, just because somebody doesn't like what somebody else said online or something. It's crazy. I'm not on Facebook or anything like that, but I understand Facebook does the same thing. You can have a Facebook campaign that just basically identifies someone and they go after them. It reminds me of what I used to see in the yard with the chickens. You remember? Used to see this one little hen, and she never had feathers on her neck. She was the one that got henpecked, and they wouldn't leave her alone. Once that one was identified, they'd usually die eventually. That chicken would die because the other hens wouldn't leave her alone. They'd just pick at her and pick at her and pick at her until she died. That's what cancel culture is like. And that picture is not much different than stoning, when everyone around grabs a rock and throws it. But that's not what Jesus was about. Because God is not like that. God wishes to gather all of his lost children to himself. In Matthew chapter 23, Jesus said, "Jerusalem, Jerusalem, who kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to her. How often I want to gather your children together the way a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, and you were unwilling." He says, my goal, my job, my will is that you would be gathered as my children under my wings, as chicks under my wings. Now, here's God in one of the times in the Bible where he refers himself in the feminine as a hen covering her chicks. You see, God, we refer to him as him, but he also said he made man and woman in his image. He gathers the hen, gathers the chicks under his wings to protect them because he loves them. He wants to gather all of them, but you are unwilling, he says, to come. This is my job. This is my goal. This is why I live. I am God. I am love. I want to gather you. And in the psalm, he says, chapter 91, psalm, he says, he will cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. You will not fear the terror of night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plagues, nor the plague that destroys at midday. That's where you will find refuge. Under his wings, he will protect you. If you ever seen an eagle's nest, if you can watch one of those little cameras that they've got set up, you can go online and find eagles that are raising their chicks, and you can watch them 24 hours a day. Might get a little slow middle of the day, but in the sun, the eagle will literally spread her wings or his wings over the chick and cover it from the sun to protect it. Just like that. And God says, that's me. I am protecting you from the heat. I will take the heat. My wings will protect you. You'll find refuge and shelter underneath my wings. Another way, another metaphor that is used is adoption. Paul uses this in Galatians. He says, and I will be a father to you, and you shall be sons and daughters to me, says the Lord Almighty. That he will adopt you. He says it again in Romans chapter 8. He calls it the spirit of adoption. This is not just the act of adoption and going through the formalities of a legal process. He said there is a spirit that exists without even signing a document. For all who are being led by the Spirit of God, these are sons of God. For you have not received a spirit of slavery, leading to fear again, but you have received a spirit of adoption as sons, by which we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are children of God. Now, I've enjoyed being in the wild of Oregon. I talk a lot about being on the trails, but I also enjoy being with my friend James on a boat, or I've gone out with my brother-in-law before on a boat, and that's kind of fun to go out there, and my brother-in-law kind of likes to find a secret cove that nobody else comes to, because it's quiet and you're alone. He says, if we can keep all the yahoos out of here, we'll have a nice day. And of course, as I told my daughter when we were hunting, she said, Daddy, who's a yahoo? I said, anybody but us. It is on that day that I have the spirit of exclusion. I want everybody to stay away. If I see someone on the trail, it's not a good feeling for me. I don't want to see anybody else out there. I want to be alone. I love it. The wilderness is spoiled when you come up on another group. Oh, I thought we were doing something special. You're here too. So you hear somebody's boat coming and you're like, oh, great. The boat starts rocking with the wake and everything. You see, we have a spirit of exclusion in that situation. And God says, I don't have that. I say, everybody come. Everybody come. I don't want you to stay away. I want you to come and join me. And yet we have a spirit of exclusion. We're going to look at three things today. First, God's word is given to reveal truth, but it is often used to cancel people. Folks, the church has been doing cancel culture since it started. Don't look down your nose in the culture. The church taught them everything they know. Second, Jesus showed accusers how to love the woman they considered unworthy. And third, we will always be disappointed when we seek to cancel others. You will never, ever be satisfied. You know why? Because you need to do it again as soon as you do it once. And then you got to do it again, because the high does not last for long. You seek to cancel everyone. The amazing thing is, once you cancel everybody outside your group, you have to start looking within your own group. It's when you see people turning on each other who used to be allies, because they have the spirit of exclusion, the spirit of slavery. They seek to destroy instead of to gather. They seek to exclude instead of include. Jesus didn't work this way. We're going to see that in just a minute. First, God's word is given to reveal truth, but it is often used to cancel people. Let's just look at this in verse 1. Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. Jesus went to the Mount of Olives after teaching in the temple. He would go back again, but he left the temple and he often bivouacked. You know what that means? When you're in the military, you bivouac. You set up your camp. You just kind of shelter there for the night. And Jesus often did this on the Mount of Olives. A lot of people did that would come to Jerusalem. Now keep in mind that people came from all over Israel several times a year. This was particularly for the Feast of Booths, but they also come for Passover. So there are other times in the year where they would come and gather. Folks, there aren't enough motels in all of Jerusalem to put them all up. And most of the people couldn't afford it. So in other words, this is a pilgrimage. Several times a year they had to make this pilgrimage. Now, Israel is not a big country, but it's still about 100 miles. It's still several days' journey, hard journey, up to northern Israel. Probably more like a week if you're taking your time. Remember, people aren't riding on wagons mostly. They are walking. Now, the roads were pretty good, but there were stretches of it when you got off the main road where you had to be careful of the bandits. So when they would get there, they would all arrive at once, because all the people of Israel were there to celebrate together. It was like bringing the whole family together. All the tribes would gather, and they would celebrate. They would honor God at the temple, and they would make their sacrifices on, on at Yom Kippur, Passover, whenever it was, and they would do all of their things, but they had to have a place to stay, and Jesus often stayed on the Mount of Olives when he went to Jerusalem, probably because his family had done that his whole life. His family had done that his whole life. He probably had his favorite rock right there, his favorite tree, and that's where he would stay. So he was at the Mount of Olives, a place he knew very, very well. He had come there all his life. It's like, and I can take you, in Oklahoma we have this little place, we don't have many of them, but we had Red Rock Canyon. Now they've got one of those around Vegas too, I understand. It's supposed to be much more impressive. As in most things in Oklahoma, it wasn't very big, but it was a state park. We have to do with what we got. And we used to go there a couple times a year, and we would have a family reunion there every summer. So I'd usually go there about three times a year. And I got to know that place like the back of my hand. I could tell you the best way, because it was all rim rock around the edges. I knew every place you could go up through the rim rock to get up to the top. And when we played our games of tag and hide and seek, and we played them all over that canyon, I knew every little nook and cranny of hiding spots. I knew where the snakes were and where they weren't. I knew where the cactus was going to get you if you weren't watching. I knew all that stuff. I knew everything. This was Jesus's Red Rock. He knew everything about Mount of Olives, I guarantee you. As a boy, you think he stayed right in one spot. All the boys would get together and they'd run around and say, come over here, look at this, look at it. They knew where to get water. They knew exactly where they were. So Jesus knew this place very well. Early in the morning, he came in again into the temple, and all the people were coming to him, and he sat down and began to teach them. Now Jesus was now teaching regularly. Every time he came to Jerusalem, he would just simply set up and people would gather to listen. People would ask him questions. Are you going to do any miracles today? I bet he got tired of answering that one. But he was teaching, and the scribes and the Pharisees. The Pharisees were not alone this time. The scribes came with them. The scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman caught in adultery. And having set her in the center of the court, they said to him, "Teacher, this woman has been caught in adultery in the very act." Now, right away, you know this is not just a matter of happenstance. This wasn't just a spur-of-the-moment thing. The scribes and the Pharisees had been conspiring in secret how they were going to deal with Jesus. They expected him to be there. They probably even orchestrated the adultery, would be my guess. Because when you need to find someone in adultery, sometimes you may not be able to find them. Maybe they had a volunteer to help set her up. But they found a woman that was a likely candidate who would certainly be willing, and they set the trap. This woman was not in any way central to their plan. Jesus was the focus of the plan. This woman was just a thing. She was bait. They were using her to get to Jesus, and they really didn't care what happened to her. We've seen that in our culture, that people use others. Politicians doing it constantly. Right now, it's happening right as we speak. People are being used as pawns. Right now, there are people in Portland that they know who they are. They were trying to burn down the police station. They tried to burn down the courthouse on multiple occasions. We've all seen the videos, firebombs being thrown everywhere, knuckleheads. And right now, have you been in downtown Portland? Don't. It is a third world war zone. It is a mess. And it's not safe. I'll tell you right now, it is not safe. If my wife had to go to Portland for a meeting, I said, nope. I'd say, honey, I don't ever tell you what to do, but I insist you not go. I would not let my family go to Portland. That's just how bad it is. Those people up there have made that a place of destruction, is the best way to put it. And I'm not talking about politics in any way, shape, or form. Whatever their views are, whatever they're protesting, I don't even know what it is that they're protesting. It's not race. It's not. They're just protest. They're just raising heck all the time. And it's not peaceful. It is violent protest. Even someone was murdered there last year. And it's in that case, it was just politics. He had the wrong color hat on, and he was murdered. People are being let go without charges, right and left. Yet there's a group of people that went to Washington, D.C. and did some really stupid stuff, but they did basically the same thing, but less violent. They're going to spend, some of them, 20% of the rest of their life in prison because of one day, one decision. Some of them not even violent. One guy's just walking around, he got 4 years. He may have 30, 40 years left in his life. That's 10% of his life he's going to spend in prison for walking around inside the halls of the Capitol. And yet other people are not being. That's called cancel culture right there. That's called using people as bait to win an argument. It's evil. It's just flat out evil. Now, if you did something wrong, if you did something violent, you need to pay the price for it. But we're not treating people the same. Cancel culture picks on certain people for personal reasons, for reasons not of justice. That's the main thing we see here in this story. Jesus is about justice. You think the Pharisees care at all about justice? This woman is being used by them. Therefore, she is being dehumanized. What that means, dehumanizing someone means you don't even see them as a person. They're just a means to an end for you. You're just objectifying them. When a man looks at a woman with lust in his eyes, he's dehumanizing her. He's not looking at her wanting to compliment her. He's wanting to use her for his own purposes. You see, that's dehumanizing behavior. And we do that to one another when we seek to cancel each other. When we just seek to ruin your life and to get you excluded from the family of civilized society. And Jesus was sitting there, and they brought this woman who, as far as they were concerned, could have been a piece of meat. That's all she was to them. All they could see was Jesus. They did not even see her. They couldn't care less about this woman. They didn't care if she was guilty. They didn't care if she was innocent. They didn't care if she lived. They didn't care if she died. They didn't care one bit about her. What they cared about was embarrassing or disempowering Jesus, trying to get him to make a mistake, having him make a wrong answer. In Matthew 19, there was another example when the Pharisees came to him and said, "We've got a question for you. If a man dies and she marries her brother, whose wife? Or can you, if you're divorced, can you remarry?" What, all these questions that they would bring to Jesus were just, they could care less what the answer was. They were trying to trip him up. They don't care what the answer is here. We know that. "Teacher, this woman has been caught in adultery in the very act." Jesus knew the law. They knew that. They said, "Now in the law, as you know, Moses commanded us to stone such women. What then do you say?" Now, if he says, "Stone her," then he's going to lose half his audience right there. Because he's supposed to be love. That's what he keeps talking about, is love. God is love. But if he says to them, "Let her go," we've got him. Because he says the law is not important. Either way, we've got him. This is what their questions were always designed for. Therefore, what you have here is what has to happen in a canceling of someone in our culture. It's a conspiracy. People have to work together to come up with a plan and then to pull it off. And it takes cooperation at several levels. Again, if it's just local folks, nothing's going to happen. But if it gets into that national media, boom, their life is over. It can just happen that quick. Your life can be ruined in a heartbeat. Sometimes people are doing it for political power. Sometimes people do it for money. Sometimes to alleviate the competition. In pharmaceutical companies, that happens all the time. They're trying to dirty trick one another to try to get them out of the market. Happened with the EpiPen not too long ago. The EpiPen now costs $700. 10 years ago, it cost $100. Why? Because some people got canceled. So now we pay seven times more. So when they asked Jesus, they weren't interested in the answer. They were looking to conspire and take their conspiracy to that next level. They kept trying these things and they didn't work. But they said, this time we're prepared. So that's what's really important for you to understand in this story is that the Pharisees came with an agenda. They were not looking for information. Almost never when they asked Jesus something were they looking. That's different from what Nicodemus did, the Pharisee who came to Jesus in John chapter 3. He truly was looking to learn. He wanted to know what he did not understand. He was looking to understand Jesus. These men were not. They were looking to entrap him. So we're going to look at a few subpoints. First, cancel culture is as old as mankind. We're not going to go into great detail on this story. You know the story of Cain and Abel. But it began way back then. You could even go back to the serpent canceling Adam and Eve by lying to them. But look at this. Cain and Abel are brothers. And Cain made a sacrifice. Cain brought some of the fruits of the soil as an offering to the Lord. But Abel brought fat portions from some of the firstborn of his flock. The Lord looked with favor on Abel and his offering, but on Cain and his offering, he did not look with favor. So Cain was very angry and his face was downcast. First of all, Cain did not offer God the first fruits. Clearly, God said, when you make offering to me, you give me the best. You don't give me the scraps. Because that's what we do a lot of times in our life, isn't it? When I was growing up, we had a scrap bucket, sat under the sink. Mom would put scraps under there. She'd throw them out to the dog at the end of the day. But if it was just grease and stuff, it got put in another jar. But that was the scrap place, it was under the sink. When that scrap bucket would fill up, you had to throw it out. And God says, don't pile up your scraps and give them to me. I don't do scraps. I do the first fruits. You give me the best of what you got. Abel did that. Cain did not. Cain was upset that God had noticed it was not his first fruit. But instead of dealing with reality, he chose to deal with his anger by going after the guy that he thinks made him look bad. What he doesn't realize is nobody can make you look bad before God. Nobody can do that. No matter what you are accused of, God knows. He knows your heart. He knows whether you're innocent or whether you're guilty. Other people don't. They have to make a judgment. God does not. He knows. Cain, instead of dealing with the problem, which was his own heart, he dealt with his brother. The Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry? Why is your face downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted?" God wanted to receive Cain. You know that the price for being accepted into my family is the first fruit. Why would you give me your scraps? "But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you, but you must master it." You must master sin. It is sitting right outside your door, waiting for you to make a mistake. So Cain, God explained patiently how Cain could repair the damage that he did to himself. Now Cain said to his brother Abel, "Let's go out to the field." Clearly Cain did not listen to the Lord. And while they were in the field, Cain attacked his brother Abel and killed him. Because Cain made a bad offering to the Lord, he took his wrath out on his brother and canceled him. Then the Lord said to Cain, where is your brother Abel? I don't know, he replied. Am I my brother's keeper? That's called mouthing off in my house. Right? Doesn't that sound like a smart aleck kid talking to the Lord like a smarty pants? Yeah, where I come from, you didn't do that. Kids do today, but boy, where I came from, you didn't do that. Somebody ever, if one of my friends had ever done that to his father, the rest of us would have gone, we would have left tiptoeing out and got on our bikes and got away from there quick because it was going to come down. God had told Cain patiently what to do, and then Cain killed his brother. Cain's heart was dark with sin. He had separated himself so far that he thought killing or canceling Abel would make him feel better. The Lord said, what have you done? Listen, your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. Now you are under a curse and driven from the ground, which opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. What you see there, folks, is Cain's decision to cancel himself by the judgment of God. God did not cancel him. Cain canceled himself by trying to cancel others. This is what happens to those who cancel others. Right here. Ultimately, your end is your own destruction. You may just want to hurt other people. It only destroys you. Second, Jesus was clear about his mission of salvation rather than judgment. We've looked at this in great detail when we went through John 3 with Nicodemus. For God so loved the world that he gave his only one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. This is very clearly not. They did not understand what Jesus taught to Nicodemus. These were Jesus' words to Nicodemus, that I did not come to judge the world, and yet they bring a woman to him for judgment. That's not why he was there. That's not what he said. He didn't say to the Pharisees, that is not why I've come. I've come to save the world. He didn't say that. He said it to Nicodemus. It's quite possible that they may have heard the words from Nicodemus. Nicodemus may have shared some of that with his Pharisee friends, because he was the teacher of Israel, remember. He was a teacher. Third, the joy of heaven is released upon the inclusion of one lost sheep. Then Jesus told them this parable. This is in Luke chapter 15, the first of three parables in Luke chapter 15. One of the high points of Scripture when we talk about why we're still on this earth. Luke chapter 15, the first parable is the parable of the sheep, the lost sheep. Then Jesus told them this parable. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Does he not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, rejoice with me, I have found my lost sheep. I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. Cancel culture is the opposite of this. We're not going to risk the 99 to go look for one. And yet Jesus says, that's exactly what I do. I exist to find the lost sheep. I exist to include and say welcome to those who want to join. I want everyone here. I'm not going to exclude anyone. If you have a party, you invite the people you want to be there and you exclude the ones that you don't really hope to spend time with. What if they show up anyway? Kind of spoils your night. You say, well, that's a real boundary violation. Jesus says everyone's invited to this party. Everyone. And we will rejoice in heaven when one sinner turns. No matter what they've done, no matter who hates them, we will rejoice. They are a lost sheep, and we will celebrate that they have been found. All this, of course, comes from the adversary. First Peter tells us that be self-controlled and alert. Just like God just told Cain, you got to master sin in your life. Be self-controlled and alert, because your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour, just looking to eat someone's lunch. He cannot wait to destroy. This is what the Pharisees were all about, is it not? They were looking to destroy someone. Why? Because ultimately they wanted to destroy Jesus. But Jesus showed the accusers, right in the midst of this life and death situation, not only did he show the accusers, but everyone else there, he showed accusers how to love the woman they considered unworthy. Now, this is one of the most amazing things that you will ever see. Almost anything Jesus said there could have been taken as a mistake on his part. That's why they came up with that. Okay? They were looking for a way to trap him. Lawyers are good at this. They try to ask the witness questions that make them look bad. They try to expose what they're really about. But Jesus didn't jump up and down and wave his arms and say, you should be condemned for this. He didn't yell at the Pharisees. He didn't say that they were horrible people. He stooped down to the ground with his finger and he wrote on the ground. They could have been praying. Maybe he was thinking of what to say. Maybe he was drawing something in his own mind. But he was in thought, for sure. He stooped over. I mean, it's just an odd posture. When somebody is challenging your authority or your wisdom, when you bow down, that's almost a sign of humility to say, oh gosh, I hope I get this right. If you're defending your dissertation in front of a committee of professors, you don't want to bend over and write on the ground. I'll tell you that right now. It's not a place of power. And yet Jesus stooped over and bent on the ground, wrote on the ground. I think there's one other thing that I didn't read this anywhere. I don't have many original thoughts, but I had this original idea about this scripture as I studied. Jesus stooped to write on the ground. Where do you think the woman was? She was on the ground, in tears and broken. I think Jesus was right there next to her. He may have even whispered something to her, we don't know. He may have said, I love you and it's going to be all right. You hang in there with me. I know that that was the spirit of what he wanted to communicate to her. I think he stooped on the ground to give her the message that he was there with her. Folks, Jesus is with you, stooping over right when you need him, at your worst, at your most vulnerable. Jesus is right there. And I know for a fact and experience that I don't usually feel it. I know he's there. In my head, I know it. I don't feel it. I feel alone. I feel desperate. I feel in pain. I feel I'm not going to survive it. The woman was in that vulnerable position. We're going to talk about her next week. Remember, this is about the Pharisees today. I think it's his way of separating intellectually. The Pharisees were asking him a question, trying to better him mentally. They were asking him a question to trip him up intellectually. And he broke connection with them to go and connect with her. I think that's what stooping on the ground was all about. They put her right in the middle. It says right in the middle of the court. He was sitting at the front of the court and he bent over closer to her, away from them. When they persisted in asking him, they weren't letting him think. They were mocking him, probably. What's wrong? Got no answer? Thought you were supposed to be a smart teacher. What happened, learned carpenter of Nazareth? Got nothing to say? You don't really know the scriptures. You get off your game a little bit, you ask to answer a hard question, and you got nothing. You are about to fail in double jeopardy. Jesus sat there close to her, stooped over on the ground. When they persisted, they were peppering him with questions, mocking him, making fun of him. They may even been telling the woman, "He's got nothing, lady. You're about to die." Because they didn't care about her. He finally stood up. He said, "I'll be back." And he stood up. He said, "He who is without sin among you, let him be the first to throw a stone at her." Let him who is without sin among you, let him be the first to throw a stone at her. Suddenly, the question stopped. And they began to look at each other. Who's going to do it? Who's going to be the one that throws the first stone? If you'll do it, I'll do it. But you got to be first. Not me. I wish we could go online and write to all these anonymous yahoos who try to cancel people. O sinless one, what have you done worthy of being canceled? When we try to cancel people, when we try to run them out of town on a rail, we're just basically saying, "I can't convince you of anything, so I'm just going to have to destroy you." People that have no argument seek to undermine people with dirty tricks. That's what political campaigns are all about, trying to destroy someone else, and it doesn't matter if it's true. They could care less. All they got to do is win the election, they'll deal with it later. In this case, the woman's life depended on it. And Jesus said, "Let the first one of you without sin cast the first stone." That stunned them, stopped them in their tracks, and their questions stopped immediately. Not another word was spoken. They began to look at each other. When it was clear that no one was willing to step forward and throw the first stone, the people in the crowd began to murmur. Now, it doesn't say that in the scriptures. We just know what happened, right? When those guys didn't throw a stone, and by the way, you could have heard a pin drop when Jesus said that. And after a short time, people began to say, "Look, they got no response. God, that guy's smart. Wow. What did we just see? Those are the smartest guys around here. They're the ones, they're the bullies of the temple. They're the ones that get onto us if we aren't dressed right. They're the ones that yell at us if our sacrifice isn't good enough. They're the ones that are hypocrites because they're scumbags and we know it, but they act like we're the ones in the wrong." And now they got nothing to say to Jesus. The crowd began to murmur, and then the Pharisees saw that they were bested. They just saw it as an argument. They didn't care about the outcome as long as Jesus was embarrassed. They didn't care about anything else. But when they saw that what they wanted to do was not going to happen, they just began to turn and walk away quietly. When they heard it, they began to go out one by one, beginning with the older ones. Isn't that interesting? You see, the older ones knew we got nothing to reply with. The younger ones were like, "Come on, somebody do it. I'll do it if you do, somebody." The younger ones were less anxious to leave. They were just too stupid to know that they had no response. And when he was left alone and the woman where she was in the center of the court, So you notice it says right there, Jesus was with her. That's what made me think of that Jesus stooped down to be near her, to whisper to her, to minister to her with his presence. Folks, that's what's happening here. Jesus showed how to love. But he didn't only show how to love the woman. He showed how to love the Pharisees. You may not get that first time you look at it. But what he did was the most amazing, loving thing that someone could ever do for another human being. They could model love in a way that they would never forget. If you're a hard-hearted Pharisee that only cares about rules, how could you ever change? Because nobody can convince you of anything. You already know it. You already know everything, right? Right? Pharisees were educated Archie Bunkers. They'd sit in their chair and act like they know everything. And they'd be grouchy and grumpy. And when you try to tell them something, they don't learn because they're too busy defending something they don't even understand. That's what a Pharisee does. The only way to break through to someone who thinks they got all the answers, who thinks they're right, and is not looking for anything else, the only way to break through them is to melt their heart. You see, God isn't out to convince the smart people. He's out to love them. God is about loving people. He's not trying to win an argument. Why would an elephant need to cheat in a contest with an ant to see who weighs more? I mean, can you think of that? Think of that for a second. An elephant would never lose a contest to see who weighs more. But sometimes they might think, well, maybe I just need to make sure I win this, and they cheat. And then they get disqualified and the ant wins. Why would God need to argue with smart people? He doesn't. It's not about winning intellectual arguments. It's not about tricking anybody. It's not about saying, wow, let's let God impress us with the intelligence of Scripture. At some point, someone's heart has to melt. It has to soften so that their heart can receive the love. You see, the Pharisees were looking for the wrong thing. It's not that they were looking for love in all the wrong places. They weren't even looking for love. They were just looking to be right. They were looking for power, and their heart was hard. That's the only way that you can put a woman there that you have conspired to destroy. You could put her there and only look at her as a piece of meat on the road to your agenda being accomplished. So when they heard it, they began to go out one by one, and Jesus was left there with the woman where she was in the center of the court. I love that image of Jesus being there with this woman that was being vilified as a woman caught in adultery. Now, we already know that Jesus didn't have a problem talking to a woman. We learned that in John chapter 4. Beautiful story. I've had very close friends that are women, which is dangerous for preachers. My wife is a very graceful, understanding person. I grew up with a lot of some of those girls, and they were very close friends, and Jeannie let me be good friends with them. Folks, there are folks that say you shouldn't be a pastor if you're going to have a woman that's a friend like that. There are people that would say the same thing about Jesus saving that woman's life. How dare you? She was caught in adultery. How could you defile yourself? And Jesus said, because I'm teaching you about love. You see, it's not about the law. You see what Jesus was doing there? It had nothing to do with the law. What they cared about, the only thing they cared about, Jesus said, I'll show you something bigger. This is the new covenant. It's love. And he bent down and loved that woman. He loved her just by his presence. His presence, his mere presence was love. How do you argue with love? You can't. You can only try to kill it. You can't argue with it. Folks, think about that. You've been in an argument. What if you were just overcome in the middle of that argument with love? The argument stops because love cancels all arguments. Love just loves. We will always be disappointed when we seek to cancel others. As the Pharisees walked away, they heard it. They began to go out one by one, beginning with the older ones. They had to show back up at the Pharisee headquarters, licking their wounds. And the scribe show up and said, "I thought you guys had a plan. We made us look up a bunch of idiots. Are you crazy? I have never been so humiliated in all my life. Last time I let you plan a conspiracy. I can do better than that." Okay, you're up. Your turn. Now who's going to destroy Jesus? "Well, I've got this idea about marriage. If we talk to him about marriage, that'll get him. Then we can stone him." I don't think that's going to work either, but give it a shot. The Pharisees were disappointed. But I also think by the way they walked out, Jesus got to them that day. I think Jesus pierced the heart of a few of those guys. They walked out. They said, "Man, he's on to something there. There's no response from the law that I could think of that would ever be able to defeat what he just did. He loved that lady. She's our sister, a daughter of Israel, and we were going to kill her." I would like to think that the end of the story is some of them saying, "Man, I got to rethink my life." Probably not. Most of them probably just tried to redouble themselves and say, "Let's not be embarrassed next time." When you try to cancel other people, when you try to say you are not worthy, you will never be satisfied. There is nothing good going to come from it. Folks, I've also been involved in one situation of church discipline in my life. Is the worst thing I've ever done in church, ever, by far. Hated it, every minute of it. Hated it. Made me not want to be a preacher again. Because I didn't like it. I didn't see any other choice. I'd tried, I'd talked, I had asked for understanding, and that person had some pretty crazy ideas about trying to get other people on board with that person's agenda. It was tough because I did not want to do what we did. And we got together as a group of elders and we had to literally say, "You're not welcome in this fellowship." It was not what I wanted. Interestingly, I'm kind of friends with that person today. Not close friends at all, but we talk. We're not hostile to each other. And I hate what happened. But we followed the scriptures and we had to do what we had to do because it was disruptive. And that's what the church discipline process is about, is sometimes you have to exclude someone. But let me tell you, the whole process is designed for reconciliation and restoration. The process is designed to restore people, but the person wouldn't budge. We said, "We can't have that here." It was tough. Even though it was right, it was terrible. I hated that. I hope I never have to do that again. I do it because I have to as a pastor, but I would hate to do it again. It's the worst thing I can ever imagine because the church is about bringing people in, not excluding. And in that case, we had to exclude someone. It's horrible. We are not designed as a body to be exclusive. But let me tell you, folks, this is where I got to turn our fire on the church. The church has been the greatest purveyor of cancel culture in the history of modern civilization. The church has been used to cancel others more times than we can count. Sometimes it was used for murder. Sometimes it was used just to shame. Even when I was a kid, the church was still shaming people for certain things. The difference between shaming and asking God to convict someone is vast. When we shame someone, we say, there's something wrong with you. We tell them that you aren't good enough. The church definitely needs to preach the gospel. We need to preach the truth. And we need not compromise one bit on what the Word of God says. But we also need to understand the scriptures in the light of what we just looked at in John chapter 8. That Jesus never wanted to cancel anybody. He wanted to include everyone. He was looking for lost sheep till the moment his last breath was taken. Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. Father, forgive them. Our exclusion of others must be as an absolute last resort in obedience to Scripture. Everything we do must be about including people, regardless of race, liberal, conservative, how they think, how they dress, economic status, whatever it is, including people is what God is about. That we are to all be adopted into the same family. Let's pray together. Father God, you have called us to love. And I pray, Father, that you would teach us to even love the Pharisees among us as Jesus did so beautifully. In this story today, Lord, you just showed how smart you were when you were on this earth to be able, in one statement and one act, to show both absolutely beautiful truths. That is that God is love, and that love is truth. We thank you, Lord, for the way that you modeled love today. I pray that we would be able to do it for others, and it would be our absolute default mode, Father, that we love one another, that we would never seek to cancel out someone else. For those that are canceling, Father, I pray that you would convict them for their role in the pack of wolves that they run in. Let them see, Lord, that it is an effort at destruction. There's no compassion in it. There's no good cause good enough to justify it. Father, we pray for the conviction of the hearts of those who would cancel others. And we pray, Father, for us today that we would learn how to love someone by what we do instead of just what we say. We thank you that you were willing to stand next to this one that needed you that day. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for joining us online. If you would like to join us next week, we'll be here at 9:30 here in Bend, Oregon. Or if you want to watch online, it'll be available also next week. Thanks for joining us.